all of you this evening. Thank you so much for joining me for yet another stream of the next game alphabetically in my Steam library. Today we're playing The Beginner's Guide, which for some reason is not showing up properly on the screen. I'm going to fix that in just a minute after I finish doing my intro spiel. So thank you again for joining me for the next game on my Steam library list. Once again, I am playing each week to raise money for Extra Life for my local children's hospital, which, due to COVID, currently has zero ICU beds, so they could definitely use the funding. The link, if you'd like to donate, is there in the comments, and I'll be putting it in the description as well when I upload this over to my YouTube channel, which I have. I also include it on my reviews, which I also write, and I could provide a link to at any point, I'm sure. But first, I'm going to figure out what's going on such that the beginner's guide is not streaming properly, so give me one moment. Change capture this one. Done. Come on. Hey, there we go. Now it looks like it's streaming. Sometimes it just takes a moment. Alright, so we're gonna go through The Beginner's Guide. The Beginner's Guide is a game that's been in my library for a while, but has been unplayed, but I'm familiar with the general concept. So we're gonna see how this one goes. It is a story game, I think. Don't hold me to it. We're gonna see what this is. But first I'm going to set the audio down a little bit so that you all can hear me. Yes, I do want the captions. Perfect. Alright, let's play The Beginner's Guide. Yes, my audio is on. Thank you, game, for reminding me. My keyboard is usually set in Dvorak, so anytime something tells me I have to use certain buttons. Thank you very much for playing The Beginner's Guide. You're very welcome, narrator. I wrote The Stanley Parable, and while that game tells a pretty absurd story, today I'm going to tell you about a series of events that happened between 2008 and 2011. We're going to look at the games made by a friend of mine named Coda. Now, these games mean a lot to me. I met Coda in early 2009 at a time when I was really struggling with some personal stuff, and his work pointed me in a very powerful direction. I found it to be a good reference point for the kinds of creative works that I wanted to make. So just to start you off, this is, I think, the first game he ever made. It's a level for Counter-Strike. You can walk around here, by the way. And mostly it's just Coda learning the basics of building a 3D environment. One second, I have to change the keyboard controls. He says you can walk around, but when you're... Alright, edit buttons, move forward. Come on. These are the problems. I not only play on touchpad, I play on my keyboard in Dvorak. So.
But even though he starts from the simple aesthetic of a desert town, he then scatters these colorful abstract blocks and impossible floating crates around the level. And of course, it destroys the illusion that this actually is a desert town, and instead this level becomes a kind of calling card from its creator. It's like a reminder that this video game was constructed by a real person. And it kind of makes you wonder, what was going through his head as he was building it? This is what I like about all of Coda's games. I mean, not that they're all fascinating as games, but that they are all going to give us access to their creator. I want us to see past the games themselves. I want to get to know who this human being really is. And that's exactly what we're going to do here. So, it's 2008, Coda starts making these games, and he never releases any of them. He doesn't put them onto the internet, he just makes them and then immediately abandons them, and they sit on his computer forever. And I think he really understood this jokingly renamed his computer's recycling bin to Important Games Folder. So, you know, this was just how he worked. He tended to crank them out one after the other without even really pausing to try to understand what he had just made, until suddenly one day, he just stopped. In 2011, that was it. He made his last game, and then he hasn't made another one since. And that's why I've taken this opportunity to gather all of his work together, is because I find his games powerful and interesting, and I'd like this collection to reach him, to maybe encourage him to start creating again. And if the people like you who play this also happen to find his work interesting, then I'm sure it'll just send that much stronger of a message of encouragement to Kura. So thanks for joining me on this. If you have a particular interpretation that I haven't mentioned here, or if you just need to get in touch, you can email me at daveywreden@gmail.com. Okay, that's about it for introduction. Let's take a look at Coda's first proper game. As each game is loading, I'll show you the date that it was completed.
The
first one was made in November 2008.
I've previously played the Stanley Parable, and I can tell... Well, we'll see where this is going. Oh.
This game is called Escape from Whisper, and it's one of the more generic games you'll see from Coda.
Oh. Why would I fire the gun? I accidentally clicked. Okay, well... Uh-oh.
It kind of looks like this game is a developer. For instance, you have this gun, which you'd think would indicate that there are supposed to be monsters or enemies. And clearly, there are no enemies anyway. You can't even reload the gun when you run out of bullets. But ultimately, we don't really know. Maybe Coda thought that actually it was complete the way that it is. And I think that we should talk about his games for what they are, rather than for what they're not. I love how you can see the bottom of the universe in this world.
That is pretty cool. That's not a door.
Apparently, the space station has a labyrinth on it.
Left-hand rule.
Sure, I don't know.
Left-hand rule.
There's no reason for it that I've ever been able to discern, so in the interest of time, I'm just gonna skip you on that.
Oh, thank you so much. You are the best narrator. Let's have a look. That's a very casually asked question. Hey, I've played Fallout 3. I should have a super mutant here that I can push in the way. Oh, so it is like Fallout 3. In that now I've reloaded so that I can push that super mutant in. Oh.
This is an important moment for us, because yes, this is technically a glitch, but Coda identifies something human about it, like how small it makes you feel in the face of this larger chaotic system. Or this floating could be the afterlife, a peaceful place, juxtaposed against all of the hysteria that you've just had to traverse. I don't even know. I have no idea what he was thinking, but what's clear is that after making this, something lodges itself in his brain. He wants to do more of these really weird and experimental designs. So he stops work on this and moves on to a stream of tiny little games that go in all sorts of directions. Let's go ahead and take a look at the first game he made after leaving this one behind. Yep, in this game you can only walk backwards.
Oh, thank you so much, game. I thought it was me going crazy. Okay. I am now entering.
And that's it. Okay, the meaning of this game won't be clear just yet. Please be patient with me for a few more games, and I promise you'll see what makes it interesting. Oftentimes, Coda would put bizarre titles like this one at the start of his games.
I do like the stairs.
I wish I'd known him at the time that he was making these early games. He would really only talk to me about his work as he was making it. Once he stopped work on a game, like, that was it. It was dead to him. And I don't agree with that at all, but what are you gonna do?
I'm thinking about the idea of death of the author. Thinking about death of the author in relation to that statement about once he was done with them, the games were dead to him. And like I said, I've not played this game before, so I'm curious about where it's going, but I suspect that that idea is going to be coming into play here. There's a couple of these that hit a little hard.
Go ahead and see if you can solve it.
says actual puzzle. All there is a lever.
Don't forget that solution, because we're going to see this puzzle again soon. We're going to see it a lot. Seems to be it, right? You walk down a corridor, solve a puzzle, and get to the end. Simple enough. Alright, now I'm going to modify the game again, so that when you press enter, it'll remove all of the walls from this room.
Oh!
How about that? There was more to it than we had any way of knowing. I actually find it funny that this game comes after the Stairs game, since they essentially convey the opposite idea. So, in the Stairs game, a dull exterior concealed a rich interior. And then, in this level, a dull interior hides this fantastic outer world. Either way, I think that the point is the same, is that most of the time, you don't get to know what you're missing, or even that you're missing anything. That's not your role as a player. So if your role here is not to understand, then what is it?
I repeat once again the concept of death of the author and...
So, this, combined with the entering game from earlier, tells us that Coda believes his games are connected somehow. It could even be that the Stairs game and puzzle game are literally connected in between this and the entering game. There's a bigger picture that all of his games are meant to play a role in, some larger meaning that we won't be able to grasp until we've seen all of them. And once we have, we can step back and start to understand what exactly that bigger picture is.
I like that you can tell that there's a contour of a hill.
Certain things that it does well, and it has certain things that it does poorly. One of the things that it does very well is boxy linear corridors. That's why so many of Coda's games are set in these large, flat, empty rooms, is just because he's working with what the engine does well. The tools available to the creator shape what kinds of creative work they're going to end up making. You might consider paying attention to the architecture of Coda's games. Notice how they seem to stem from an engine that's very good at producing linear boxy corridors.
This one just feels unnerving. I do mind.
This is something that he and I used to argue about a lot. You know, whether a game ought to actually be playable, whether it means anything if no one can get through it. And I would always defend that, you know, all this work goes into the game, why not make it playable and accessible? And so we just got into heated arguments over it, and there was one time that after one of these conversations, he went home, and a day or two later, he sent me a zip file entitled, same solution as the last time. There's still no clear indication of what makes this puzzle so special that Coda is going to return to it over and over. But I promise I'll share with you my interpretation very shortly.
That is very ominous.
And so we make one last descent down to the final floor of the level. For some reason, Coda fixates on this lamppost. It's going to appear at the end of every single one of his games from here on out. I'll tell you what I think. I think that up to this point, you know, he's been making really strange and abstract games with no clear purpose, and maybe you can only float around in that headspace for so long. Because now he wants something to hold on to. He wants a reference point. He wants the work leading to something. He wants a destination. Which is what this lamppost is. It's a destination. We're going to see it in the work as well. His games are just going to become a lot more cohesive, a lot more fully developed, with more of a clear idea behind them. And as we go, that idea will get clearer and clearer. So first off, I'm sure you can deduce this, but this game is not connected to the internet. All of the notes that you're going to see have been written by Coda. This was actually the first game of his that I ever played. This was shortly after I met him at a weekend game jam in Sacramento, where I grew up. I saw him working on this very level, and it was just so different from anything that anyone else was doing. So right away I was like, I have to be friends with this person. In retrospect, I think I was probably a bit too pushy trying to get his attention. I was over-enthusiastic. But he was very gracious about it and very patient. And I pulled off eventually. Oh, feel free to skip over any of these notes if they're not doing anything for you. Nothing extra is going to happen if you read all of them.
Now that he says nothing extra will happen.
To me, they convey a sense of loneliness. I see this person who's filled with thoughts and feelings and beliefs and has no way to express them except as scattered and unheard voices in a game that wasn't meant to be played. But it's ironic, isn't it, that in playing this game and seeing how alone Coda often felt, that we get to know him better and actually kind of connect with him. And I have to be honest with you, this idea is really seductive to me. That I could just play someone's game and see the voices in their head and get to know them better and have to be less of the messy in-person socializing. I could just get to know you through your work. I think this is why I always liked Coda games so much, is because it felt like they let me have that connection. I felt as though he was inviting me personally into his world. And then I feel less lonely too.
Okay, guess we don't jump over there. I swear the dots move. Is whispering.
In each of his games, after exploring a theme that, you know, he might find difficult, Coda can then place this puzzle that he knows has a reliable solution, he understands exactly how it works, and so it gives him a simple mechanism for moving on. There's this dark area between the doors, a space between spaces. Before you move on, you get to pause. Just for a moment, a few seconds to reflect on and let go of the events that led you here. To step back and connect the pieces together, to grasp at that elusive bigger picture.
Well, I like the furniture. This is a very aesthetically pleasing apartment.
See, like, this is it. The whole game. And there's nothing that's particularly interesting about it. You just walk to the end of a hallway. Except, for some reason, Coda gets really fixated on this prison that has all of this modern furniture. And I don't know why, but he decides he needs to revisit this prison. He's gonna start over, use the same assets, turn it into something else. Okay, cool. Here's version 2.
No furniture.
There's a bit more to this one, but still, it's not really communicating anything. It's kind of just weird for weirdness' sake.
It's an IKEA! We are all trapped in IKEA!
Thank you. gone and you can't begin the chain of events to escape. Here's a version where there are no bars, but you can't actually get to the well. And then a version where the inside of the prison is the outside, and the outside is the inside. Let me just blink you real quick through a few more of these. You really unloaded on this prison idea. There's nearly enough. Personally, I think it's awful to see a person basically unraveling through their work. And for what? Like, at what point do you just go, maybe there are game ideas other than this prison that I could be working on? But voice against yourself. Without it, you just hide it. And so he keeps going and going and going and going and going. And then he hits on something. And he likes it. And that's it. He's done. He stops making prisons. This is the very last version of the prison game that he created. And the reason I think it works is that the prison is not actually in it. Thank you.
This is just like doing real chores where it never ends and it's the same chores over and over. I don't like chores.
Through the game, the perspective shifts. And you play as the teacher. And suddenly, you discover that your teacher is just as bigoted and afraid as you are. Oh, and also you can move around the classroom now. Some other person perfect and totally fulfilled in every way and completely miss all of the little flaws that make them individual. I think about this game a lot these days. This one took a lot longer than all the others for Coda to make. It was 4 months between this and the last one. That's twice as long as it took him to make any other game before this. And it's not like it's particularly complex, so I remember I found that a little strange at the time.
Cats out there, right? Says keep my eyes closed. I really want to open my eyes.
about in his creative frustrations, this one turns it up to 11. Now, put yourself in my shoes, friends. Here's a friend whose work is exhibiting signs of struggle, frustration, anxiety, depression, even. And yet, still, he keeps making games. Keeps throwing himself into the grinder, even when he clearly doesn't have the energy for it anymore. Why? What is it for? Because, from my perspective at the time, and what I knew of him, this was a result of how isolated he was. He was in his own little bubble, just sitting at his computer all day, not really showing these games to anyone, not releasing them onto the internet, and so he didn't have anyone outside of himself to connect with. He had no outlet to ground himself on. And the answers. Then there's no movement. Then there's no circulation. If all of your anxieties are being channeled into your work, then if the work ever fails, you have no backup and you're just going to crash. so now the work is becoming self-destructive. And I'll tell you, at the time that I first played this game, shortly after he made it, here's what I'm thinking to myself. I'm thinking that Code is stuck in his own head, and that it's having a very negative effect on him, and that all he needs to do is just start showing his work to people, to get some actual feedback on his game. It might get him out of isolation. And so, as I'm thinking this, I realize that I could be the one to initiate it. Because it would never occur to Coda to start actively soliciting feedback, so what if I did it for him? If he could see the difference it would make to have more actual conversations with other human beings, would that bring him out of his mental spiral? Would it give him confidence in himself? Would it bring meaning back into his work?
Oh no. No, don't do this.
I started showing Coda's work to people. I took this one, and the island that you just played, the theater, the notes, the house cleaning game, and some of the prison escape game. I brought them to people that I knew and trusted. I asked their opinion. And the great part is that they really loved this game. You know, the point of it all is just to give them some external reference point, but they genuinely loved his work. There was nothing for him to be afraid of. When someone really connects with a thing that I've made, when they see themselves purely in my work, there's nothing that feels better. And I got to give that very same feeling to my friend. I did something... I really felt like I'd done something good. Like I was a good person. Felt like there was a friend who was in trouble and was unhappy and maybe didn't like themselves. And I could fix it. If I could give him this gift, maybe I could fix the problem. Told me how much they enjoyed his games. It was the best feeling. The absolute best feeling. It made me feel so happy. So beautifully, beautifully happy. So anyway, Coda finishes this game, and then really he just kind of takes off for a while. So this is June of 2011, and I didn't hear anything from him for several weeks, I guess. And so out of nowhere, one day I get an email, and it's got a private link to a new game of Coda. This one is called The Tower, and to my knowledge, it's the last game that Coda ever made. So let's take a look. Of the maze are invisible, and then every time you touch one of the walls, there's this awful flashing and noise, so the experience is really miserable. The game goes beyond not being meant to be played, it actually seems to despise the player for trying to play it at all. But I do want to show you the rest of the levels, so when you're ready to continue, press enter and I'll put a bridge over the maze. it's not like this is the first game that's needed some modification to be playable. Like the house cleaning game. You know, that one used to actually loop the cleaning chores and you'd just clean the house forever. I had to cut it off so that you could exit the house and the game would actually end. But that game had an idea that it was actually trying to communicate. What's the deeper idea behind the invisible maze? The only way past this challenge is to randomly guess the six-digit code. Like the invisible maze, it's frustrating to me, because it's the opposite of everything else that Coda has made. It doesn't encourage thought or engagement. It doesn't ask anything of me, except a lot of my time. If I could have reached it during this time, then maybe I could have asked it, but I couldn't. I still don't really understand why this is here. I'll put the code on the ground for you here, though, so that we can move on. Open this door is actually on the other side of the door, meaning that it's literally impossible to solve from this side. So even if you somehow brute-forced your way through the first two challenges, and you got to this point, there's actually just no way to progress. And it's serious. The idea of cutting yourself off the field, just saying, you know, that's it, that's the end of the conversation, not giving me any way to fix the problem. I feel like a failure, I guess, when I can't. Fix the problem. But I can open this door for you, so let me do that. Was I a failure for not understanding this game? I don't know why I would be. It's not like everything needs to have a solution. I feel it somehow. I feel like I failed, and I don't understand why. I remember, it's June 2011. I'm playing this for the very first time. And as I'm playing, I'm thinking to myself, I don't know this person. I have no idea who this person is. It wasn't the guy I knew. It wasn't my friend. I had come to so many conclusions from looking at all of his work up to this point, and then suddenly none of them... I had been trying to, though. That was the thing. For years, I was trying to get to know him, to understand who he actually was and what he stood for. I asked him so many times to please just tell me what his games mean to him. I asked him please to tell me what the three dots mean. And he wouldn't. I just felt so strongly that if I could have connected with him, that if I could have somehow made his work my own, that I would finally be once and for all happy. Is that I needed to see myself as someone else. I needed to be someone other than me. But he stopped and left. And it felt somehow like I had failed. Making games, aren't I? It's because of what I did. Poisoned it for you. I don't think I ever told you this, but when I took your work and I was showing it to people, it actually felt... It felt as though I were responsible for something important and valuable. And the people who played them, they treated me like I was important, listened and cared about what I had to say. Even though I was showing your work, it was... I felt good about myself. Finally, for a moment, while I had that, I liked myself. And then you stopped, and I didn't have anything left to show you. I just had to be with myself. And as soon as that happened, there was no feeling at all. Nothing. Less than me. What is that? That's why I'm releasing this collection of your work, is because I haven't been able to find any other way to reach you. I've tried everything. And so a part of me has hope that if I put this compilation out into the world, and if I put my name on it, that maybe enough people will play it so that it'll find its way to you, so that I can tell you that I'm sorry. I know I screwed up. If I apologize to you truly and deeply, will you start making games again? Please, I need to feel okay with myself again. And I always felt okay as long as I had your work to see myself in. I mean, is something wrong with me? Because I know that I did an awful thing, and I'm doing it again right now. Like, I'm showing people your work, but I can't stop myself from doing it. That's how badly I need to feel something again. Like, I'm an addict. There has to be something wrong with me. Can I apologize? What if I tell you I was wrong? Will that work? Will that fix it? I don't know. I don't think it will, but there's nothing else that I can do. Just tell me what you want. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Please, start making games again. Please help me. Please give me some of whatever it is that makes you complete. I want whatever that wholeness is that you just summoned out of nothing. You put in your work. You were complete in some way that I never was. I want to know how to be a good person. I want to know how not to hate myself. Please. I'm fading, and all I want is to know that I'm going to be okay. Someone had told me ahead of time that he just really enjoyed making prison games, maybe I wouldn't have thought he was so desperate. Wouldn't have told so many people that he was depressed. Maybe he just likes making prisons. Even now. being driven by external validation is unthinkable. Like, I actually cannot conceive of what that would be like.
So I think this may be the second game that I've actually finished on this stream while people have been watching, so thank you for going on this journey with me. Sorry for being quiet there at the end. This game gave me a fair amount to think about, much like the other game that we finished. But yeah, like I said, thank you so much for joining me on this journey through the Beginner's Guide. It's definitely very different from what I expected. I'll be writing a full review, and you're welcome to read it if you'd like. No worries if you don't, I'll be writing it anyway. Once again, I'm planning to raise money for my local children's hospital. If you're interested in donating, I put that link in the chat, and it's available, I think, in the Twitch channel description, too. Not quite sure. But especially since we don't have any ICU beds here in Texas, your donations are appreciated. Thank you for joining me. I hope you have a fantastic night wherever you may be, and a fantastic rest of your week. I will see you again next week, where we will be playing Beholder. In the meantime, I wish you all the best. Have a good night. Bye.